And welcome to the 22nd meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. And before we start, I do want to congratulate all members of the committee who contributed to ensuring that we won this Power of Change Award at last week's Holyrood Awards. It is a committee award, not an individual one for myself as convener. So thank you to everyone. And doubly thanks to Michelle, who won the Political Hero Award on Thursday night as well. Thank you. Thanks very much, folks. I did actually name everyone at the committee to ensure that you were all recognised, including new members such as yourself, Jamie. You also get the nod. Okay, let's go on with the meeting what we have at hand. The first item on our agenda today is an evidence session with the Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance on the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax Green Freeports Relief Scotland Order 2023, SSI 2023 draft. The Minister is joined today by Scottish Government officials, Laura Parker, Land and Building Transaction Tax Policy Lead, and Laura Duffy, Head of Green Freeports Policy and Delivery Unit. I welcome our witnesses and invite the Minister to make a short opening statement.
Well, thank you, Convener. Good morning to the committee and congratulations to the committee on your award and congratulations to Michelle Thompson and her award. But having been in front of this committee several times, I know praise and flattery isn't going to get me off the hook. So I will go on with the matter at hand. The Land and Buildings Transaction Tax Green Freeports Relief Scotland Order 2023 provides for relief from LBTT in part or in full for qualifying transactions with any designated Green Freeport tax site. Green freeports are designed to support businesses to create high-quality, well-paid new jobs. The successful bidding consortia are currently developing business cases that will set out plans to establish hubs for trade, investment and innovation, promote regeneration and make a significant contribution to achieving our net zero ambitions. The Scottish and UK governments have made a commitment to deliver a green freeport model that meets the needs of the Scottish economy and offers all of the benefits that are available to those situated in freeports in other parts of the UK. LBTT relief is offered on that basis. It is part of a package of incentives for green freeports and is designed to be equivalent to the stamp duty land tax relief that is offered to other UK freeports, ensuring that the overall objective of parity of treatment between freeports and green freeports is met. The LBTT relief supports the wider programme by encouraging investment in specific tax sites on land that is under or undeveloped. The legislation enables businesses to start to benefit immediately from the relief when the tax sites are designated, and the relief will be available for a period of up to 5 years. I welcome the evidence submitted by a range of organisations in response to both the Government's call for evidence and the Scottish Government's own consultation on the draft instrument, and I look forward to members' questions. Thank you.
Yes, thank you very much. As you probably know from the official report last week, there was quite a lot of discussion and deliberations regarding all aspects of the Green Freeport proposals. So one of the things, of course, is the importance of attracting green jobs into these green ports. But there was an element of frustration I felt from our witnesses last week in that there doesn't appear to be a definition of what a green job actually is. So, for example, on two occasions, Derek Thompson of Unite the Union said that does someone, you know, on an electric bike making deliveries, does that person count as a green job? So I'm just wondering if the Scottish Government has a definition of what a green job is so that we're not having a discussion by comparing apples and oranges. We don't have a situation where everyone around here has got a different view of what a green job might be.
I think it's a very important point to raise, Convener, and I recognise it's one that various administrations, devolved level, local government level, UK level, internationally, will be engaging with. Obviously, within the private sector, various organisations will be assessing their own commitments around sustainability in regards to green jobs and trying to attempt to find a stable definition. Clearly, this is something that has evolved in recent years as tackling the climate emergency has moved to the top of the political agenda domestically and internationally. So there has been, as you would imagine, an evolution in terms of the development of some of the language that is used. If, for example, I take what the ONS have published in March of this year, a green job is defined as employment in an activity that contributes to protecting or restoring the environment, including those that mitigate or adapt to climate change. So this definition is sufficiently broad to encompass a range of green jobs, including those related to decarbonisation and net zero. And I also understand that it's anticipated that the ONS will publish estimates of green jobs in the UK in the next few months. There has also been other work done in this particular space. The Green Jobs Fund, which was launched by the government in 2021, used the definition of jobs and businesses that produce goods or provide services that benefit the environment or conserve natural resources. And again, just to add to that, in December 2020, with the Climate Emergency Skills Action Plans, a definition again, green jobs include those in renewable energy, the circular economy and zero waste, and the nature-based sector with wider green skills sitting on a spectrum ranging from highly specific requirements in sectors directly supporting the transition to net zero, such as energy, transport, construction, agriculture, manufacturing, through to more generic requirements across all sectors to thrive in a net zero economy. So I recognise in that that definition is quite broad and can be quite all-encompassing, and that may understandably prompt questions about where does one draw the line. But I think it speaks to the point that net zero is not something we do specifically. It is something that runs through all aspects of the economy. And of course, as we move through that, and in the case of green free ports, as OBCs are developed, and as we monitor and evaluate the progress that is made with the green free port model, I think there will be further refinement and greater understanding of what we specifically mean by a green job. But I hope, as an opener, that helps to set the scene and develop some of the thinking that's been taking place, both within Scotland, but also more widely.
Yeah, I mean, I think that was very helpful, but you did quote three definitions. It would be good if we could boil it down to one specific definition, because again, it leaves room for ambiguity, and I think that's something we want to try and reduce as we move forward. One of the issues that came up was the timescale that will be made available for investors, and both the United Union and indeed David Mellish of the Scottish Property Federation felt that 5 years really wasn't enough. I mean, Unite said as long as possible, and David Mellish said, well, it can take up to 9 years and for investments to come through. So if we're wanting to ensure that these green ports are impactful from as early as possible and attract as much investment as possible, is the Scottish Government thinking of extending the 5 years, and what is the logic behind 5 years?
We don't have any specific plans to extend beyond 5 years. Part of the logic of 5 years is having parity with free ports and other parts of the UK. So if Parliament approves these regulations, the LBTT relief would the permissive environment for that relief to come into effect would take place from the 1st of October, but the relief could only be specifically claimed following tax site designation, which is a process involving HMRC and HMT. So on the question of 5 years, it is to ensure that there's parity with the offer being made elsewhere in the UK. There is also the element that we would anticipate that there would be early investment. We do recognise that there will be some investment which takes place, which enables further investment to take place at a later date within that five-year window. Of course, we will keep the overall five-year period under review should there be any delays or unanticipated problems with regards to the tax site designation. But I would stress the five-year time frame is really to help ensure that there is consistency and parity with the offer that's available with free ports elsewhere in the UK.
But the Scottish Government specifically talked about free ports and green ports being different. So why is the Scottish Government not trying to give itself a competitive advantage by making it 7 or 9 years? I mean, because you've put a number of strictures on green free ports, which one might say makes them less competitive, albeit the fact that, towards businesses you might not necessarily want to attract in the first place. But it just seemed to me that if you're looking to have success for the Scottish Green Port specifically, then why not do something different from what the UK is doing in that? Are you being prevented from doing that, or is this a Scottish Government decision?
Well, I think in terms of the approach that we're taking in Scotland is recognising the need in areas for parity, but also to tailor the model more specifically to the, particularly to the comparative advantage we have in Scotland, hence a particular focus on net zero and decarbonisation. Now, the point about a longer time frame, for example, for a specific relief such as LBTT, I can appreciate the points made around having to assemble capital and put together various bids and proposals. But what we also want to be doing is to be incentivising development to be taking place as soon as possible, because there is also a pressing urgency in the activity that we want to see take place within Green Free Ports, particularly given the role that will play in our decarbonisation and net zero agendas. So, as I say, it does bring parity in terms of that offer, but we're wanting to make sure we're incentivising that investment and development to take place at the earliest possible stage. But of course, we will have a process of monitoring and evaluation that goes on throughout the period of the reliefs being in place. There will be transparency through the information and data that will be published by Revenue Scotland. So there will be ample opportunity to measure the impact that the reliefs are having, both by government, other stakeholders and Parliament.
Okay. I mean, in terms of pressing urgency, we're talking about I find the numbers quite fantastic that are being suggested, 25,000 for Cromarty, 50,000 for Leith. So if we're thinking about Cromarty, obviously you'll be expecting people to move to those jobs, but what's being done in order to build the schools, you know, the homes that these people actually need? If you're talking about trying to get these people in early, how's the infrastructure being upgraded to actually ensure that can happen? Because you have to provide a huge level of support in terms of the infrastructure behind a green port just to ensure that the people have somewhere to live apart from and take their kids to school apart from there.
Well, there's two elements I would highlight within the overall package for each of the Green Free Port sites. There is the £25 million of seed capital will be available. But I think more crucially in that point of having a coherent approach and taking into consideration infrastructure, including schooling, local government is of course part of that consortium approach. And local government in terms of their responsibilities around local development planning are clearly key partners in that aspect. So it's by making sure we have all the right people at the table in local government with their statutory responsibilities in that regard are at the table, which will help to ensure that there can be a coordinated approach to address the particular issues around infrastructure that you highlight.
Displacement is a key issue. So, for example, Cambridge Economics said that of the enterprise zones that were set up in the UK, which lasted from about 1984 to about 2012, 50% of the 126,000 jobs, more or less half were effectively displaced from elsewhere. In a Scottish context, between 2012 and 17, there was an increase in private sector jobs and enterprise zones that were set up here in Scotland of just 16,000, compared to an initial forecast of 54,000, and 34% of those were relocated from elsewhere through displacement. So, what lessons have been learned by that? I mean, the UK actually had 7 free ports, I understand, up until about 2012, and the last one, Liverpool, closed then. So they've not really had a great history of success in terms of doing what it says on the tin. So what lessons have been learned?
The question of displacement is a key one, and it is an active part of our consideration in terms of an engagement with the individual Green Free Port sites and the overall process, and I know it will be a key concern in terms of for local government as partners. I think the risk of displacement is when transferring jobs from one part of the country to another. What we are trying to do here with this particular model is to create new high quality jobs, jobs that respond very specifically to the assets and strengths of particular areas. And we can recognise that in the where there are similarities, but also where there's distinct differences between each of the Green Free Port sites. And also, what I would want to come back to is the discussion that took place at committee last week, and just recognising that the model which is being referred to going back to the 1980s is in many respects from a different era, and it's important, of course, to learn lessons and to recognise the risks are that can take place when you seek to incentivise development in one particular part of the country. But it's also important to recognise that we are in a different era, and that some of the particular issues which were pertinent in the 1980s and early 1990s are not so now or to the same degree. Different labour market, also a different focus in terms of this primacy around tackling the climate emergency, decarbonisation. But I would come back to the key point around displacement. This is about creating new high quality jobs as opposed to moving jobs from one part of the country to another.
Yeah, I mean, assuming that every single job created in these green fuels is a completely new industry, new manufacturing business, whatever it happens to be, I mean, people who are highly skilled in other parts of Scotland and beyond will still want to move there, and will that not exacerbate labour shortages and create inflationary pressures in other parts of the economy?
There can create challenges, but in terms of what we've sought to do with the design of these reliefs, it's about incentivising new development. So if we think about specifically what we're considering committed today around LBTT, this is looking at land that is either undeveloped or undeveloped, i.e. land that would perhaps not be seeing any development were it not for this intervention. It's a reserved area, but on the employee national insurance contributions, employer national insurance contributions, this is with regards to new jobs that are created, which helps to mitigate against that risk of jobs being transferred from one part of the country to another. But I'm ambitious in the sense I hope if there is any displacement, it's not from other parts of Scotland, but from other parts of the UK and other parts of the world, people coming to work in Scotland, attracting these high-quality jobs, and as Public Finance Minister, high-paid jobs, which can help to generate the revenue to support public services. So I think there's a real opportunity for us in these cutting-edge industries where we do have some comparative advantages and we can be world leaders, to be attracting people from out with Scotland, other parts of the UK and beyond. And I certainly hope that is what happened, and where we have been able to take action around the shaping of the tax policy, for example, in LBTT, it's to incentivise development that would otherwise not take place.
Okay, just one last question to me, because loads and loads, I'm sure other people want to come in. I mean, the officials behind the UK government's reports perspective were, according to David Mellish, very impressed by the Scottish government's prospectus, but Unite the Union seemed frustrated that there didn't seem to be much engagement with the trade unions, and indeed he said that Edinburgh City Council were really weren't listening to them or keen to engage. So there was almost a kind of accusation that this was deliberate. So I'm just wondering what engagement the Scottish Government is having with trade union partners in terms of these developments.
Well, specifically, as you would appreciate, on the point of how individual local authorities choose to engage, it's maybe appropriate for me as a minister to comment in that regard. The decisions are properly for individual local authorities, and certainly our broader approach as a government, both on development of fiscal, economic policy and wider industrial relations, is to have close engagement with our trade union partners. In terms of the actual process of developing the proposal and the engagement that's taking place today, I'll perhaps ask Laura Duffy if she can come in and just provide some background about the broader engagement that has taken place.
So when we were initially looking at this proposal, there was engagement with the trade unions when Mr McKee was the lead minister on this. He met with the trade unions and a wide range of stakeholders on a number of occasions to discuss the developing policy. And we have, as you'll have seen within the policy, put Fair Work at the heart of that, as the minister refers. We can't mandate trade union recognition. However, we've made a strong recommendation for workers' voice within the governance structure of the Green Freeport. And as part of the business case process, the two Green Freeports will be required to set out their strategy for embedding Fair Work across the Green Freeport areas, because that was part of the policy development specific to Scotland that we did for this as a ministerial priority. So we'll be looking very closely through the business case process at the level of ambition within that part of the OBC around Fair Work and embedding that.
Okay, thank you very much. And that concludes my questions, at least for now. So I'm going to open up the session to colleagues around the table. First will be John, to follow by Liz.
Thanks very much, convener. Minister, you've used the term underdeveloped a number of times, and that obviously is in the schedule and the policy note and so on. Can you clarify what underdeveloped means? Because presumably if you had a one-storey building on a site and you knock it down and put in a five-storey building, that's developing it. So is every site underdeveloped?
Well, it's underdeveloped and undeveloped. And I think as well, there's obviously going to be a relation for some sites to go and reach for development potential will require other developments to take place around that, not to give too convoluted an answer. This is about helping to allow areas to realise their full economic potential. And the LBTT relief is designed to support these particular developments to take place, as I stated earlier, which would otherwise not take place. Now, as regards to what we would define as underdeveloped, there will, of course, be variations from place to place. So this is a place-based approach. So the context of what underdeveloped would mean in a specific instance and specific circumstance, there would clearly be some latitude within that. I don't know if the law has anything you want to sort of add more broadly in terms of the terminology.
So part of the detail in the prospectus sets out the criteria for underdeveloped or undeveloped land, and part of the process that will run alongside our assessment with the UK Government of the outlying business cases, Treasury and HMRC will scrutinise the proposed tax sites and look at the maps very closely to ensure that they meet with that criteria for undeveloped or underdeveloped land. And that's part of making sure that we're not trying to attract business into areas that are already quite active. Some of the proposed tax sites are basically just a piece of empty brownfield land, and the ones that aren't will go through, similar to the brownfield land pieces, through that very strict scrutiny process run by Treasury before there will be any approval for the tax sites to be switched on.
I mean, I can understand if it's a piece of brownfield where something's been demolished and it's just been sitting there, which we've certainly got in Glasgow. But I was wondering, so is it quite black and white then from the Treasury's point of view as to what is undeveloped and underdeveloped?
Yes, it's set out in the Green Freeport prospectus. I don't have the details to hand, but we can certainly point in the direction of those if that's helpful.
Okay, that's helpful, thank you. In the schedule, it talks about full relief. This paragraph applies to a land transaction if at least 90% of the chargeable consideration for the transaction is attributable to qualifying Green Freeport land. And I just wondered why 90%? So why not 80% or why not some other figure?
I just wanted to come in with the details.
Sure. So the 90% for full relief is intended to capture those scenarios where, in practice, most of the transaction is used for a qualifying purpose. So if you have a factory, 95% qualifying use, and then 5% is used for caretakers' quarters, not technically a qualifying use under the legislation. So a caretaker's quarters, which is sort of technically residential. So it captures those scenarios where in practice it is wholly used for a qualifying purpose. In terms of how we identify the right number to use, we'll sort of give consideration to the full range, but for SDLT, the range of 10% to 90% was used. So for consistency, we also used those figures for LBTT.
Okay, thank you. And I think I understand that. And then, so also the idea of partial relief, is that kind of tied in with the same thinking?
Yes.
Yes. Right. And partial relief could mean a variety of levels?
Yes. So partial relief could be 20% qualifying use, 50% qualifying use, anything between that 10 and 90%. The less than 10% figure is... sort of allows us to give consideration to the entire substance of the transaction. If more than 90% of the land or the building is not being used for a qualifying purpose, that's not really the type of transaction we would want to seek investment into in terms of the tax sites or provide relief to, because it's sort of not really aligning with the wider objectives of the Green Freeport programme.
Okay, that's helpful, thank you. Minister, as far as the actual cost is concerned, I think the SFC has said it's under 5 million and so they're not taking a view because they don't consider that material, but it's still a chunk of money. Do we have an actual figure as to what this is going to cost?
Well, as you correctly identify, Mr. Mason, the SFC did stated would be below the materiality threshold of £5 million. Given these things are demand-driven, it can be challenging to necessarily forecast with the degree of precision that we would like. But there would be an expectation that many of the transactions that would take place would be leases rather than conveyances. And if we look at leases as a total proportion of LBTT revenue, say, for example, 21 to 22, it works out about 3% of overall for the whole of Scotland. So we are talking around, relatively speaking, small sums of money, but reliefs that can be very meaningful and impactful with regards to decisions on whether individual transactions should take place. And, of course, there's also the point to bear in mind that these are transactions which we would anticipate would otherwise not be taking place were it not for the relief being in place.
Yeah, which is what the convener's already been asking about as to whether things might be displaced. Because if a business goes to one of these sites instead of, say, Glasgow, that would mean less money coming in to the government.
But it would be recognised that the nature of these tax designation sites, they're very specifically drawn, very clear defined boundaries. And clearly, the overall Green Freeport sites are chosen for a number of reasons against the criteria, but the place as well is an important part of that. There will be comparative advantages that these particular parts of Scotland, that these particular sites have. But what we are just looking to do is to remove barriers to investment that could perhaps not take place elsewhere, but could take place there if these barriers were removed. So again, it's that point around displacement. It's the case that there's investment potential there which would not necessarily take place where these reliefs not put in place.
So are you effectively saying there's no loss of revenue to the government?
I can't. I'm not going to try and outthink the SFC on this and say exactly. What I'm trying to say, point I'm making is in terms of reducing the evidence available past revenue from leases as a proportion of overall LBTT, the assessment in the, May economic and fiscal forecast of the SFC, this would fall below the materiality threshold, is that we are talking in the scheme of overall LBTT revenue, never mind the whole devolved and semi-devolved tax revenue, a relatively small amount of money. But that is not to say that that is not, does not translate into a meaningful impact on individual transactions which can influence positively commercial and investment decisions.
Okay, thanks, convener. I'll leave it at that.
Okay, list to be followed by Ross.
Thank you. Can I just pursue this point, if I may, Minister, and particularly in line with the job that this committee has to scrutinise the budget? In your answers there, you gave some idea of what the potential costs might be. And if we take that five-year period that we spoke about earlier, has the government done some arithmetic about the benefits that would accrue, particularly from the creation of new jobs in that five-year period, whereby hopefully we would be getting, particularly the high-paid jobs, we're getting a greater return on tax revenues from income tax, etc. Have we done any analysis on the benefits and the costs?
I don't have a specific set of numbers that I can share with you, but I would anticipate that the successful outcome would, as you highlight, lead to a net gain for the Scottish economy and indeed the public finances. The exact timescales in which that will be delivered, of course, are going to be influenced by a number of factors, individual commercial decisions, the overall macroeconomic environment that we find ourselves within. But a key point would be, and come back to again, is that this is about seeking to incentivise investment that would otherwise not take place. And clearly would be economic benefit and gain that would come from that. Yeah. But with regards to specific timescales and seeking to forecast when we would get a return on the investment, I'm not in a position to give that.
Nonetheless, one of the criteria that would be used to judge whether they were successful or not is whether the overall benefit is to the net gain of the Scottish economy over a certain period of time, because that's what's obviously important about these.
Of course, and in regards to the convener alluded to the ambitions around job creation in both sites, if that is realised in high-quality, high-paying jobs, and I think it follows from that, that would be a significant return on investment relative to LBGT exemptions, for example.
Yeah. And just related to this, which is a very important point that's made by the Scottish Fiscal Commission, namely our demographic structure, that one of the difficulties that we have in the Scottish economy just now is the fact that our demographic structure, in terms of the working population size against the total population, is a problem for us. Do you believe that the Greenports initiative can not only help to create new jobs, but can actually get some people who have left the labour market to come back in to help some of the issues that we've got in the Scottish budget?
I would certainly hope so. I would certainly hope we would always consider ways in which we can encourage people who are currently inactive but have the potential to re-enter the labour market to do so. So I can't speak to any specific strands of work with regards to targeting those particular groups, but I think we would all hope that that would be an outcome of this approach, and that some of those jobs that are created through these initiatives create opportunities for people to re-enter the labour market and bring their skills to bear on a very exciting set of industries.
I just think it's quite an important aspect because, obviously, I mean, the challenges are so huge as set out by the Scottish Fiscal Commission, and one of the biggest challenges is to ensure that our labour market is fit for future development. And it's not just a case of ensuring that there is new investment to take up new jobs and attracting people into that, but it's actually we're going to need the skills and talents of people who have actually taken themselves out of the workforce, who tend in some cases to be in a particular age group, and to look at the two areas that are designated. I would have thought it might be quite helpful to have a look at some of that, because that's an increasing incentive that might be very valuable to us. Just on the aspect you mentioned, skills, just now, in terms of the relevant skills that go with new green jobs, and accepting one of the definitions you put out earlier, as flexible as possible, do you think that we need to do a lot more to ensure that the skills and training that we're providing fit these new green opportunities in a way that can benefit the labour market?
You'd expect me to answer. Clearly, it's a priority for the government to ensure that our workforce is skilled and is able to take up these new opportunities. And I think that there is, broad recognition that we do have a highly skilled workforce in Scotland. That's reflected across a range of metrics, not least in our consistent success in attracting foreign direct investment. With regards to specifically how the Svinken will link up with Green Freeports and how the business cases have been taken forward, I don't know if there's anything you want to add to that point, Laura.
Skills is a key strand of the business cases, so we are looking for the Green Freeports to tell us how that they will address their skills within the skills need within the Green Freeports, and we'll be looking very closely at their skills strategies that they'll be submitting as part of that.
Can I just ask for a little detail on that? When they make their application, that's a key part of what that application has to be, is that right?
Yeah, so part of the business case is looking at their skills strategy. So their outline business case will include a skills strategy within that, and we'll be scrutinising that very closely to ensure that there is that marry-up between jobs and supply of labour market.
And can you just give us some detail on what else is in that sort of job application for a
in the
a
outline
slot.
Business case. The
yes.
Outline business case form is published online, and that sets out all the different parts of it. We'll be looking at what their plans are for planning, for skills, for fair work, what their strategy is for investing the seed capital funding, what their tax site management arrangements will be, what their customs plans are. The business case will come, as you'd expect, in two parts. We'll look at the outline business case first, and that's the part that unlocks the tax incentives alongside the tax site designation, and then we'll look at the full business case, which is much more fully focused on the kind of detailed financial aspects of it. So the kind of broader brush skills, security, risk, governance, fair work, the kind of the heavy lifting on that, if you like, is done in the outline business case, and the full business case builds on the outline business case.
So the most likely to be successful if you see benefits to the Scottish economy overall in terms of the revenue that they're going to bring in, is that right?
they'll be most likely to be successful if we've got a full and rigorous business case that we'll consider across both governments.
Okay, right, thank you.
Ross, to be followed by Michael.
Thank you. Minister, the rationale that you've outlined this morning is that these companies will be given tax breaks, and in exchange they will be encouraged to pass on the benefits of that to their workers and to the wider economy. Is that not trickle-down economics?
The rationale I've sought to set out is that they are, specifically on LBTT, is there are sites which would otherwise not be developed. They would remain as they are, or underdeveloped. And the intention of this incentive, beyond the points I made with parity with the UK Freeport model, is to incentivise investment in sites that would otherwise not take place. I think with a trickle-down approach, that can be regarded to things that would otherwise take place, or through alternative models and alternative vehicles take place. It's also predicated upon the notion that those on high incomes will spend their monies in ways that are economically, social and environmentally impactful, rather than just hoard it in assets or offshore. This is about actually getting investment on the ground, development in land in Scotland that would otherwise not be developed or not be developed to its full potential.
You mentioned the traditional issue of trickle-down economics and the wealth that's generated then being hoarded offshore. Can any offshore entity benefit from this LBTT break?
Well,
a company based in an offshore tax haven will be able to benefit from this tax break, won't they?
I can't speak to the commercial decisions or operating arrangements of companies. If companies are operating and are compliant with overall UK tax law, then and they are in a position where they are making an investment, then they would be treated just as any other company, depending on how it's constituted, would make.
Sorry to jump in, Minister. This isn't about UK tax law, this is about a devolved tax. It's within the power of the Scottish Government to, for example, potentially, if they so wished, exclude any company based, incorporated in a tax haven from benefiting from an LBTT relief. But you've chosen not to in this case. Why is that?
Well, with regards to the provisions around avoidance, there are general avoidance provisions. I don't know if, Laura, you want to come in and speak to the general avoidance provisions, because I think it's an important point that the committee will be interested in.
Yeah, sure. So the relief in and of itself has its own conditions that any claimant must meet in order to benefit from the relief, and that involves using the land in a qualifying way through development, etc. As part of Revenue Scotland's ongoing compliance activity, they will assess at the point of claim and throughout the three-year control period that any claimant meets the conditions for relief. If there are any artificial arrangements put in place for a company to achieve a tax advantage that they're not otherwise entitled to, at that point the general anti-avoidance provisions set out in the RSTPA will be in point.
And it's an important point about the controlling period. If there isn't development taking place within 3 years, then the relief can be withdrawn. Ultimately, this relief is only going to take place and be utilised if development takes place on the ground. So ultimately this is about attracting investment into specific sites, and it's seeking to incentivise and unlock development in sites which otherwise would not see development, or would not be, as I've said previously, developed to their full potential.
The pandemic, the emergency measures that the Scottish Government put in place precluded companies who were based in recognised tax havens, so for example the Cayman Islands, from benefiting from Scottish Government relief, emergency relief provided during the pandemic. So the Scottish Government is quite capable of recognising what is and is not a tax haven, and whether or not a company is based in a tax haven for the purposes of, albeit legally, avoiding tax. The Scottish Government is then allowed, within the devolved settlement, to make policy decisions, for example, to exclude those companies from whether it's public procurement grants or, in this case, tax relief, but has chosen not to do so. So I'm just asking for a rationale as to why, when the premise of this is about providing these companies with advantages and in exchange they will pass on those advantages to the wider economy and to their workers, why companies who have based themselves in offshore tax havens like the Cayman Islands for the purposes of avoiding tax are still allowed to benefit from this further tax break when they could have been excluded. That's entirely a matter for the Scottish Government.
I've spoken previously about one of the key aspects being consistency with the SDLT arrangements elsewhere in the UK. But ultimately, the benefit that is going to be conferred is development, and
I apologise that I'm labouring this point, but it's development that would otherwise have not taken place. It's not as if there is a potentially a competitive advantage for one particular model of company over another, you know, or alternative development would have taken place on this side. It's a question of, does development take place or does development not take place? That is the, or does development not take place to its potential? So that is the rationale underpinning the relief on underdeveloped, undeveloped land. So there's that aspect of it focusing it. This relief is only going to be accessible if development takes place. If there's a transaction and there's a commitment to development, and within 3 years of development doesn't take place, then the relief is withdrawn. So there has to be development. Second aspect is that broader parity that we have sought with regards to the arrangements elsewhere in the UK. Well, I don't know if there's anything you want to comment about where we have sought parity with regards to the arrangements for freeports and where we have diverged.
In terms of the overall package, we've sought parity across that as far as we can within our existing fiscal frameworks. So the tax relief package, as you'll be aware, is made up of reserved and devolved reliefs. From a policy perspective, we've sought to have those reliefs designed as closely mirror the UK reliefs as possible in order to make sure that there's a level playing field across the piece. Because if they start to come out of sync, then one or other becomes disadvantaged. In policy terms, as I alluded to before, in terms of the development of the policy aspect specific to Scotland, Scottish ministers focused keenly on the Fair Work aspect, which we wrapped into the high quality, promoting regeneration and high quality job creation, and the introduction of the specific objective around promoting decarbonisation and a just transition to net zero.
If the Fair Work criteria are legally required of companies operating in a freeport, or in this case benefiting from LBTT relief, could a company, for example, pay its workers the minimum wage, not a living wage, and refuse to recognise trade unions, but still access LBTT relief, a tax break?
LBTT relief sits separate from the other reliefs. The way in which LBTT is constructed as a tax is it's transactional, it's based on the transaction, and I set out the criteria previously with regards to when that could be withdrawn, i.e. development does not take place within the control area. With regards to the broader points around Fair Work and monitoring, this is something that is clearly has to be evidenced through the outlying business case and going to the full business case. Laura, do you want to add anything more to that?
Yeah, because the two tax reliefs that we're putting in part of the package are property-based, applying Fair Work to those is very difficult. So the way in which Fair Work is built into it is we scrutinise Fair Work at bid stage. We, as I mentioned earlier, are looking for the Green Freeport strategy for embedding Fair Work across the Green Freeport area, and we'll be looking for ambition in that when we come to assess that. And the monitoring and evaluation framework that will sit across the whole programme will scrutinise the impacts of that as the programme rolls forward into operational phase. So we'll be looking very closely at what the Green Freeports say they will do and whether they've delivered on that.
My understanding, though, and please correct me if I'm wrong, is that the Fair Work criteria are not requirements. They're strongly encouraged, there's guidance, it's clearly what the Scottish Government wants out of this, I recognise that, but they're not required. And therefore, there's not a consequence, a direct consequence, if a company is not meeting Fair Work criteria as defined in the Fair Work Convention the Scottish Government signed up to.
You touched on the point, or you collide with the reality of Schedule 5 of the Scotland Act and the reservations over employment law. We do not have the power to legally require, for example, trade union recognition in these contexts. What we are trying to do is work constructively and in partnership with business, with the other partners involved, to promote Fair Work. And while we don't have the power in this Parliament to legislate in these terms, I think we have a role in terms of leadership and the convening power of the Scottish Government to seek to encourage businesses to adopt these practices. And we've been very clear in what our expectations are throughout this process.
So I recognise employment law, clearly reserved, not devolved. For years we were told that it was not legally possible under Schedule 5 of the Section 5 of the Scotland Act to require businesses, for example, either bidding for public procurement or receiving business grants from government agencies to pay their workers at least the real living wage. That is now a requirement that the Scottish Government has delivered on. That's a legally binding requirement. So it turns out that we could do that under devolved competencies. So let's put aside trade union recognition for a moment, because I recognise that's untested, though I would encourage the government to test it. Clearly, we can require businesses to pay at least the workers relevant to the work taking place, in this case within a Freeport, to pay them at least the real living wage, because we've just done that with procurement and with public grants. So why are we not doing it with the Freeports?
Well, procurement, and you'd appreciate, is distinct. Procurement is a devolved competency. We have to operate within broader frameworks at UK and WTO level, but that is distinct from employment law. But I do recognise that we have made significant progress on procurement from over the last 17 years since McClelland. We recently published an independent report at the start of the year highlighting the benefits and the journey that we've been on in sustainable procurement. And I recognise there's much more that we can do in that particular space. Indeed, it was an issue that was raised through the recently closed consultation on community wealth building legislation, and the analysis of that will be published later on in the autumn. I just highlight that on the topical matter of procurement. So where we can take action, we will, and of course, you know, when we are challenged to go further within these devolved competencies, we will seek to do so.
So why haven't we here in this case, Minister? Because as far as I understand it, not a lawyer, but have tested this particular area through policy a few times, as far as I understand it, the Scottish Government could require, to qualify for the benefits it's providing to businesses within these Freeport areas, that those businesses commit to pay at least the real living wage, but it's not doing that.
There's a distinction between procurement, grants, and then property taxes, and that's the important point. There's a distinction between what they are and how they're administered and what is possible. But there's also the issues that we have saw in terms of it through this programme being developed on these measures for parity with what is available elsewhere in the UK. So I certainly, in terms of having responsibility for devolved taxes and indeed for non-domestic rates, I'm keen to reflect upon how we can use these levers in a way, working in partnership with trade unions and with business to incentivise fair work. But we have to make sure, in considering that, we are not conflating it with distinct areas of policy, such as procurement or giving grants.
Just finally, Convener, Minister, is it not the case that this is a UK government policy that, in terms of fundamental economic principles, the Scottish Government doesn't really agree with, but the UK Government was going to do it anyway, and it's just the case that the Scottish Government is trying to make the best of this situation, and it would perhaps be better to just be honest and say this probably wouldn't be happening if the UK Government weren't doing it anyway, and it's not really what you would like to see. You're just trying to make the best of it.
Well, we operate within in a UK context, and we seek to engage constructively. This, of course, the Freeport model was something that was brought forward by the UK government, if I recall correctly, following the general election in 2019. And what we have sought to do is listen to the voices of business and other partners, including trade unions, and engage constructively in the development of these proposals. And we're in a position now where we've managed to come to a joint approach with shared decision making, and I think that reflects on the fact that we have sought to engage constructively, and I think if we continue to work in a constructive manner going forward with the UK government but with the actual Green Freeport operators, we can seek to harness the opportunity that is there to deliver positive economic outcomes for the Green Freeport sites and the wider Scottish economy, including strengthening key strategic industries.
Thanks, Minister. Plenty of other questions, Convener, but I think it's probably time for other members to get a word in.
Indeed. Michael, to be followed by Michelle.
Thanks, Convener. Minister, how important is a transparent application and assessment process to the strength of the bids?
I think it's incredibly important. There is a range of material, I think it's already been published on the UK government website, setting out various aspects of the criteria. I don't know if, Laura, you want to go through some of what has been already made available and what will be further forthcoming.
So the bidding prospectus was published on the 25th of March 2022. The the assessment process for that was done cross-government. A decision note setting out why the decision was made and what the kind of basis behind that was published shortly after the selected green freeports were announced. The publications that followed that were the guidance for business case, the business case forums for both outline and full business case. In terms of the content of the bids, we had a number of freedom of information requests, and we have released all of the information that we could within all five bids. I think, if I recall correctly, the mainstay of the information that wasn't released was commercially sensitive information. So we've been as transparent as possible with the process.
That's very, very useful detail. It's in stark contrast, really, to the process that was followed for investment zones under the government, which the Neil Gray, in a response to a written question to me, said invitation to host an investment zone was not subject to a bidding or application process. So in your words, it was incredibly important to have a proper process. Why was that not followed for investment zones, Minister?
You'll have to forgive me, Deputy Convener. I'm here specifically to speak about Green Freeports, and as not being the lead minister in that area, I don't have the information in front of me, but I'm more than happy to ask it. There's a response in writing to address any points that you have specifically there you would further want to articulate during this session.
Okay. And, I mean, I think it's a bit when we're investigating the potential benefits and value for money for taxpayers around these approaches, but also our general interest in decision-making processes within government that we have as a committee. It strikes me that there's a very different approach that's been taken. No real process that was put in place. We had, on the day of the announcement of the investment zones, Russell Griggs from the South of Scotland Enterprise wrote to say he was bitterly disappointed and that he was still awaiting the publication of the selection criteria on that basis. It's a bit confusing, I think, for people. And I suppose to take it into context, if I can, I hear the ministers, and any further reflections would be useful. But for Dundee, my home city, we have neither received a green freeport or an investment zone, despite being the fourth largest city in the country. We have the most prestigious and high-achieving life sciences institution in the entirety of the UK. We have an outstanding port, and we have huge economic need. But there has been no delivery of any of these opportunities, either of these opportunities. Is there a justification that the government can give for that?
With regards to the decisions that we're taking around investment zones, again, this is something that is a product of engagement between the Scottish Government and the UK Government. In terms of the actual decision-making process and criteria, as I say, I do sincerely apologise. I seek to provide as much information as possible to the committee, but not being the lead minister in this particular area and it not being specific to the issue of green freeports, I'm not in a position to respond fully. But I do recognise the member's interest as a committee member and as a regional representative, so happy to respond in writing.
Can I pull it into the generality then,
yeah,
if that's possible? So is this not probably an inevitable consequence of doing these things on a specific regional basis rather than a national approach? So you're here today to talk about a localised regional approach to economic development where the government is making certain decisions about how to lift up certain areas. And we're not in a situation where essentially these investment zones are just pork. You know, it's just pork barrel politics and decisions taken by the SNP and the Tories to allocate them to areas of political priority. Do these kind of approaches not open up that kind of possibility?
I think it's important to recognise that place-based approaches to economic development are integral to a range of the work that's been taken forward, the regional economic partnerships down to community wealth building. I would not agree with the characterisation of pork, and I certainly don't think anyone could suggest that from an SNP perspective that there was anything politically motivated with regards to the decision in relation to Dundee. I don't think that's a fair assessment to make. I think that there's a recognition that there is initiatives that have been taken forward by the UK government The Scottish Government has sought to work constructively and engage constructively with the UK Government on these matters and with the areas involved. And to my mind, and I think it's a fair point to make, is that response to something that is a regular call from parliamentarians of all parties, which is to see greater collaborative working, partnership working, and that is ultimately reflected in the fact that we have sought and we've been willing to engage constructively with the UK Government on these particular measures, which were originally their initiatives, but we haven't sought in any way to be obstructive. We've sought to engage and to try to ensure that we can achieve the best outcome for people in Scotland.
Yeah, I mean, to be clear, Minister, I mean, I'm in favour of locally based regional economic development, but it has to be transparent and there has to be a criteria that's applied to it. And you've got two very differing policies in terms of a government. One that has a criteria which you've set out today and one which is a complete absence of any criteria or process. So I think I don't want to labour the point any further, Convener, but if the Minister could set out, and perhaps with his colleagues, some rationale for the distinct approach that's been taken across these two different policies and writing to the committee, I would welcome that, and I think it would be useful so we can assess the general impact of these. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Michelle, to follow by Jamie.
Good morning, Minister. I mean, in fairness, I do recognise the challenges that you're operating under the wider environment. Indeed, I'll be looking forward to calls for greatly increased further devolution to avoid these sort of challenges happening in the future. But I wanted to return to Ross's comments, which I consider to be very valid. And what I took from what you were saying, that by use of the term parity, and maintaining parity, you are knowingly accepting the considerable potential for tax avoidance that feeds into all of our bottom lines, if you like. Am I correct in that assessment?
No, we're not, and that's why I made reference to the general avoidance principles that Laura touched on with a supplementary commentary in that area. I say these are specifically the LBTT, which we're considering the order for this morning. As I said, this is seeking to incentivise development that would not have taken place otherwise.
Yeah, and I get, sorry to interrupt, but I absolutely get that comment, and you made it clear about otherwise, you know, these brownfield sites wouldn't be developed. I absolutely accept that point, but it's difficult to make that point without being aware of the wider environment. And I quote again a figure I dug out a couple of years ago, that the estimated loss through money laundering crime to UK GDP is conservatively estimated at £262 billion each and every year. The National Crime Agency says it could be £100 billion more. So, to my mind, we need to be very concerned about this. So my question then is, what specific, beyond the general principles, because they're clearly not working, frankly, what specific discussions have you had with the UK government to establish how they are going to counter tax avoidance, tax evasion, and on top of the very clear warnings from the EU in 2018, which necessitated the EU itself to come out with commentary and take further actions about free ports. So what discussions, what recent discussions have you had with them?
I'll come in a moment on some broader points, but in terms of the specific engagement for UK government and the design of the prospectus and bids in regards to issues around money laundering and security.
So we're aware of the reputation of previous freeports, and that's not something we would want to see in the green freeports in Scotland. We set out in the bidding prospectus quite clearly that the green freeports would be subject to strict conditions. They would be required to adhere to the OECD code of conduct for clean free trade zones and to meet obligations under the UK anti-money laundering regulations. So green freeports will not be a regulation free area. They will be required to meet the same regulations as other parts of the country. They'll not get a free pass to the requirements that are laid upon businesses generally. The customs site operators will have to be authorised by HMRC, and the Greenfield ports will be required to keep a record of all the businesses operating within their tax sites and to share them with law enforcement agencies and make them available. And those agencies will carry out checks on the businesses and their owners before authorising them to operate.
That is pretty standard, and all of that in place does not stop the considerable money laundering and fraud that is now an epidemic within the UK economy, overseen by the UK government. And I fully accept that most of these are reserved powers. But I think the important point was Ross was making, that we have two choices. We could say, yeah, that's not very good, or we can start to rattle the cage and use what powers we have, of which absolutely disallowing any company in structure that is offshore, fundamentally. And the other point I would bring to bear is Scottish limited partnerships. These are well known for money laundering. They were at the root of the bombing in Beirut. Money was being funneled through, nearly brought down the entire Moldovan economy. I mean, they're well known and well understood. They are Scottish limited partnerships that affect our global brand name. So can I ask, if you've not had discussions with the UK government, that you have discussions with them and that you return to this committee setting out exactly what assurances you've had and where you dispute with them? Because this is our global brand, which is why I care so passionately about it.
I will ask that an update is provided to the committee as the OBCs progress and Greenfield ports come online, to try to provide additional confidence about the robust processes that are in place. But as I know you will recognise, both from your work in this parliament but also from your work at Westminster, that much of what you touch on, as you acknowledge, sits within the reserved domain. And that shouldn't be a barrier to us seeking to do all that we can. But we do have to recognise where the limitations lie, and that seeking to apply, for example, property taxes and transactional taxes in a way in which they are not perhaps been inherently designed can lead to unintended consequences, and can work against that broader objective of trying to make sure that there's parity with the sites elsewhere in the UK to ensure that we can remain competitive within this process. But on the specific request of an update, I'll ask that that is provided to the committee on the specific points that you have raised, and indeed Mr Greer has raised as well in that space.
Okay, thank you, Convener. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. And Jamie.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning to the Minister and to his colleagues. Just for clarity, I was very pleased to support the winning Cromarty Firth bid. A number of the issues that I was looking to raise have already been raised, so I'll just cover a couple of things that came up from colleagues. Minister, you talked, following the convener's questions, about the role of infrastructure in some of the other areas, schools, hospitals, housing, that kind of thing. Now, these will be vital, I think, for accommodating, hopefully, the new people, new jobs within the Freeport areas, and vital probably to the success of the Freeports. But you suggested that they were responsibility, these areas were responsibility of local government. We know that local government's under severe financial pressures. There are real pressures on services and delivering what they do already. So how, as a government, will you ensure that these services are able to be developed, given their importance to the project as a whole?
Thank you very much for your question, Mr. Alcoa Johnson. I made reference to local government in particular, their statutory responsibilities over the planning system. And of course, there are mechanisms through the planning system where development is going to have an impact on infrastructure for contributions to be made, for example, Section 75 agreements and other methods as well. So I think as we start to see this process develop and unfold, and we see the additional development that we want to see, broader consideration, of course, when developments are going through the planning process and being approved, consideration will be given to the impact upon infrastructure, and it will be for local authorities working in partnership to determine what are the appropriate mitigations, adaptations that are required, and what additional infrastructure is in place as part of that process.
That's all fine, and you talk about in partnership with who? Because, I mean, these things, these hospitals, these schools, these houses have to be built. If the money isn't there to build them, how do they get built? How will you as a government work with, for example, the Highland Council in the case of Cromarty Firth to ensure that these additional, as you hope they will need to be, resources are available?
Well, of course, there's a range of avenues in terms of which resource could be provided. That there can be, as I say, through the planning system, where there are reasons that are justified on planning matters, for resources to be accessed as part of the development taking place. Clearly, there are public resources of fund for the capital allocations to local government as well. So we will, of course, you know, as we always do, continue in dialogue with local government. Something that is more broadly across Scotland has been taken to a new and strengthened level following the Verity House Agreement. So having these discussions will continually take place, and if there's particular areas of pressure that are identified and there needs to be consideration around solutions that go beyond what an individual local authority or group of local authorities was capable of, then we would have these discussions at that particular point, just as local authorities routinely raise a number of areas. We recognise that what we're seeking to see here in terms of the creation of jobs, the development of land, presents a huge opportunity. We also recognise, of course, that significant economic development can be attended by a range of challenges. So we will continue to engage. This is not an approach whereby it's on you go and leave local government and leave the areas to it. We will continue to engage constructively, and any challenges that emerge, we'll work to understand that and identify in partnership what the solutions would be.
And is there a specific kind of vehicle for doing that going forward? Because obviously some of the decisions that are, or some of the resources that are going to be needed further down the track are going to need to be delivered through decisions being made now, consultations being made now, whether it's on, as I say, the infrastructure that we just talked about, or whether it's infrastructure such as the A9, which we know is obviously considerably behind. Is there a vehicle, or is there a specific group working on that at the moment?
More broadly, I'd point to our broader programme of infrastructure investment, which has been set out. Of course, the committee will recognise the challenges both our capital budget faces and indeed the challenges in delivering projects due to cost inflation, an issue that's not unique to Scotland, it's impacting right across the UK and many other countries. So there's that broader framework. And of course, our capital spending will of course be kept under review with regards to timing and phasing with what is feasible within the capital or disposal and the cost of projects, etc. And that's something that Parliament's well versed in engaging with specific capital project issues. But with regards to the particular sites of the Green Freeports, clearly there will be interaction with these broader projects. The A9 was the example you cited. But in terms of the actual specific impacts that could happen locally, I've already touched on that point, and we'll continue to have that dialogue and engagement to understand what any issues are as they emerge.
Okay, an almost similar kind of point.
And I apologise as well, I should just note it in terms of each of the two sites, that is the seed capital funding that I referred to earlier, okay, once they're active and online.
On a kind of similar point, obviously there are some areas where, I mean, you've suggested that you're looking for parity largely with the UK scheme, so that the Scottish Freeports aren't at a disadvantage. What's the ongoing engagement with the UK government on the Freeports projects, in terms of, for example, if there was any need to change the 5-year transaction date or things like that? How's that ongoing discussion? How's that ongoing engagement happening?
Well, it's been touched on, a situation where, subject to this order being passed, we would be in a position, hopefully, where tax site designation would take place between HMT and HMRC in the near future, which would allow the next stage forward. We continue to have active dialogue and engagement, and of course there's joint decision making between Scottish and UK ministers. I don't know if there's anything you want to add to that, Laura.
Yeah. At official level, we meet with the UK government twice a week. We're delivering this as truly in partnership as we can. We developed the prospectus together jointly. We've developed the process for assessing the business cases together jointly. The Green Freeports are invited to the UK-wide Freeport SRO forum. So our engagement is very close with the UK government. Yes.
That will continue. So if there were movement from either side on a need, for example, to change the situation, that's where it would be brought up and that's where it would be taken forward.
Of course. as I say, there's that continued and close dialogue and engagement, and that will, of course, inform any decisions that were taken, and recognising the points that were made earlier around the approach we're taking at the outset with regards to parity.
Thanks very much. And just lastly, the convener and I think Liz Smith and others have spoken about displacement and some of the impact, and also the kind of costs involved. For example, the £5 million that the kind of advertised cost in terms of land business transaction tax, but how that might be offset by perhaps increases in income tax take. How detailed will that information be in terms of from the income tax side? Will you be able to determine whether there is displacement from kind of local tax figures? Will that be an opportunity to be able to see where displacement's happening, the impact of it, and how soon would we be able to see that?
Well, specifically on LBTT, as I made reference to earlier, there'll be monitoring, of course, as one would expect, by Revenue Scotland and the publication of data. And then there's also the LBTT revenue we can accrue following the end of the exemption period as well. Given it, we can see development take place now, which can help to enable and facilitate future development. So that is one idea where you could almost say that LBTT can wash its own face in that regard before we consider the broader impact of tax. Through the monitoring engagement that goes on with each of the three ports, that will, I think, be able to assist us in being able to identify the level of job creation, the type of job creation, the type of economic activities taking place. Laura, I don't know if there's anything about monitoring economic impact going forward that you would want to add.
We're developing a monitoring evaluation framework for the programme that will help us to have some clear information, and we're working with the Green Freeports to make sure that they are clear on what the monitoring evaluation requirements will be, so that they are ready to give us the information that we are looking for, so that we can have a clear picture of the impacts of the programme across the piece.
So will that operate on a Scotland-wide model, or will it look, for example, displacement from, periphery around the Freeport, 100 miles, 50 miles?
We're looking at both aspects of that within the development of the framework.
And when would you hope that would be kind of in place? Obviously, it won't necessarily be needed for a little bit of time, but when would you expect that to be in?
The work is underway on the development of the framework. I don't have the end date, the planned end date to hand, but it's certainly well underway.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And that's concluded questions from the committee. We now turn to agenda item 2, which involves formal consideration of the motion on the instrument. I invite the minister to speak to and move motion S6M 09584. That the Finance and Public Administration Committee recommends that the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax Green Freeports Relief Scotland Order 2023 SSI 2023 draft be approved.
Formally moved.
Do any members wish to comment? Ross.
Thanks, Convener. As a setting question to the Minister, the economic fundamentals underpinning Freeports are those of trickle-down economics, and I don't think that's something that the Scottish Government can subscribe to. There's no evidence base for saying that the wider economic benefits are actually going to be felt as a result of this. In fact, the evidence base from Freeports across the world shows that the companies who are involved in Freeports certainly do benefit, but the wider communities around them don't. I recognise that most of what's involved in setting up these Freeports is reserved, but there are levers within the Scottish Government's power that I don't think have been used here. For example, excluding any entity, any company based in an offshore tax haven from accessing LBTT relief. There's a lot of language here around fair work, and I recognise the Scottish Government's commitment to fair work, but in this case it is just language. There are no binding commitments here to actually ensure that these companies are adhering to fair work principles. I'm really concerned about the long association that Freeports internationally, but particularly in Europe, have in terms of association with crime, particularly money laundering, smuggling and exploitation of workers. The European Commission has highlighted this. The European Parliament called for an end to the Freeport experiment in Europe as a result of this. And I'm not seeing evidence that there's been sufficient consideration of the impact of that in the UK. And as Michelle Thompson said, on the impact that could have on Scotland's international brand. I'm also concerned about the potential for displacement here. We saw the evidence from the UK's last experiment with Freeports in the 80s of up to 40% displacement, not new jobs being created. Given the position of the Freeports within our economy as a West of Scotland MSP, I'm concerned that the economy in the West of Scotland is already not in the same state as the economy in the East. The depopulation issues that we face are significant. Growth in wages is nothing like what it is in the East Coast. And I think this is only going to exacerbate that. So I recognise that the Scottish Government is in a difficult position here. This is a policy being driven by the UK government, but devolution exists for the purpose of creating divergence where we believe it's necessary. I don't think the opportunity to do that's been taken here. Tax breaks, deregulation, they're not the path to prosperity. Investment's the path to prosperity. Working with rather than against trade unions is a path to prosperity. You know, Greens want to see profits reinvested in local communities, not squirreled away in offshore tax havens. I think that's going to be the consequence of this. So I'm afraid I can't support this order.
Okay, thank you, John.
Thanks, Convener. I mean, I do have reservations about these green free ports, and I do fear, as has been questioned, that it is displacement rather than new jobs. However, having said that, I mean, we are competing with England in some of these matters, and so we are in a difficult position about supporting them. And based on my questioning, I mean, the amounts of money involved are relatively small. Therefore, I am happy to support the motion.
Michelle?
I have indicated some of my concerns about free ports, green or otherwise, being used for money laundering and other nefarious activities. I will support this, but with the proviso that I'll look for strenuous querying of the UK government over their pretty appalling record for stopping money laundering, but I do recognise that yet again the constraints within which the Scottish Government must operate, which is a function, of course, of devolution.
Yeah, Michael.
Yeah, I share some colleagues' concerns, I think, around particularly some of your own words can be around kind of the fantastical nature of some of the numbers and essentially the PR claims around some of this. And also, I think, but my position overall, I think, aligns probably with trade union colleagues who we saw last week who essentially, I think, in their view, insufficient engagement from the government, not talking about some of the issues that Ross Greer has raised, but recognising the fact that we're in a competitive regime internationally, but across the UK, and that our ports have to be competitive if they're going to attract business. So somewhat reluctantly, I'll support the SSI at this stage, but I think that the government could do an awful lot better on exploring the options that are available to them, and also dealing with some of these the questions that I raised about transparency, about decision-making across their economic development prospectus, to make sure that we can have confidence in the kind of decisions that they're making.
I'll make a couple of comments. I mean, I was quite keen to have a Freeport and Hunterston, actually, in my own constituency, so I'm certainly going to be supporting the motion. And the reason for that, primarily, is because if we don't get the jobs and investment in Scotland, they'll just simply move south the border. And my own view is that Teesside would be a major threat to jobs in this part of Scotland if it wasn't for the fact that Leith was actually one of the green ports. I think engagement is important. I think, you know, we have to take on board what the unions also said was that Edinburgh City Council is not engaging with them, and of course that's a Labour-led local authority. So I think other political parties, as well as the Scottish Government, have to think more about engagement with trade unions and others. But I will be supporting this on simply pragmatic and economic reasons, which is that the alternative would just be a drain of jobs and money to elsewhere in the UK. Minister, do you want to sum up? And then we'll go to the question.
I'm grateful for the committee's scrutiny and no further comments.
Okay, and I put the question on the motion, which is that motion S6M09584 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No. Yes.
We are not all agreed. There will therefore be division. Can I have a show of hands for? Against? The motion is agreed to. I'd like to thank the Minister and his colleagues for their evidence today. We'll publish a short report to the Parliament setting out our decision on the draft order in due course. I'll now suspend the meeting briefly to allow for a change of witnesses before we move to the next agenda item. So, 10:57. programme. This session continues the evidence taking on reform we started before the summer. I welcome to the meeting David Moxham, Deputy General Secretary of the Scottish Trade Union Congress. And I should say that David and I once served in Glasgow City Council a quarter of a century ago together. I intend to allow up to an hour for this session. We have your written submission, David, so we'll move straight to questions. I should say that as well as questions on reform, members may also want to take the opportunity to ask Mr Moxham any questions on the STUC's pre-budget 2024-25 submission, which has also been circulated with the papers for this meeting. Okay. Right, so hold on. Where am I? Aye, so David, just to kick us off on the kind of reform agenda, one of the things that the Deputy First Minister has said is, and I quote, it's for individual public bodies to determine locally the target operating model for their workforces and to ensure workforce plans and projections are affordable in 23, 24 and in the medium term. Is this something that the STC would agree or disagree with?
We would generally agree with the contention that public service bodies, particularly ones which have a sound democratic base, such as local authorities, should be the prime leaders and drivers of decisions on service delivery generally and workforce planning too. We would obviously add to that that decent, effective collaboration with trade unions and with the workers more generally is vital for that. Where I guess our difficulty comes is the spending envelopes which are attached to those decisions. If I may just, I guess, digress into a slightly general point, one of the difficulties that we've encountered over the years when considering public service reform is it tends to raise its head at points where budgets are at their tightest, which in many ways is the least good time to be looking at public service reform. I was involved in the process around the Christie Commission, still attach myself to many of the principles that the Christie Commission established. However, the findings of the Christie Commission dropped in 2011, which was to be followed by 3 or 4 years of tight austerity in terms of spending. Our concern is that we seem to be at one of those junctures again. So if you'd like to return to your point, the answer is yes, but what's the spending envelope and how much freedom do these public bodies have to make genuine decisions about future service delivery?
Okay, and you touched on Christine. One of the issues which this committee over many years has deliberated over has been the preventative spend agenda. Now, in terms of reform of public services, how important do you think preventative spend is?
I mean, it's absolutely vital. We've seen some decent examples of it over the last decade, too few in my view, but we would be supportive of some of what you might call the generalised government fiscal conditions, which have decisions which have sought to improve the conditions for families, particularly low-pay families and those in poverty. So it's absolutely vital. I think there's two points I would make. The first is lag time. So the investments that you make in prevention are rarely seen in service delivery terms for many, many years. Obviously, that can depend from discipline to discipline, but we sometimes fall into the trap of thinking that A follows B, whereas there's normally a B, a C, a D, and an E before you get to the F of some of the advantages that you derive in terms of service delivery and overall health and social outcomes. The second is that sometimes the preventative role within jobs isn't paid enough attention to. So I would give the example of a social worker. Is a social worker a preventative job, or is it an end of the road safety job? I mean, the answer is both. And the more social workers that you have and the more investment in social work that you have, the more that social workers are able to look at the preventative aspects of their job. So sometimes we tend to be a bit blunt tool by this and say there's a bunch of preventative jobs and a bunch of acute jobs. In reality, a large number of the jobs, particularly in local authorities, exist somewhere in the middle of that spectrum.
I mean, how difficult is it to disinvest in programmes within the public sector or services that are less effective in order to invest in more effective services at time of, you know, static budgets?
I guess I'll return to my my earlier point with bells on. Very, very, very difficult. And that's partly because it's just a bad planning moment, isn't it? So you're a departmental head, you have some, you know, medium to long-term reform objectives, but you also have a budget envelope. Are you going to be progressive, imaginative in your decision-making process? Are your workers who are fearing that they may lose their job or lose their colleague or lose their job through one of the other many methods that were used over the 2010s to diminish the local government and other workforces, is that the right environment? I mean, the answer is no. I haven't got all the answers to that problem because we've got two or three major challenges in terms of public service delivery that no one can wave a wand about. But it's not the right time to do it if you want to achieve the kind of long-term and sustainable change that I think we all agree that we need.
I mean, one of the conclusions that came out of our committee meeting on the 23rd of May in terms of the evidence that was given was that efficiencies as part of managing budgets are not really part of genuine reform, and I'm sure you would agree with that. But what role do have efficiencies through, for example, sharing of data and use of artificial intelligence, digital new technologies have to play?
I think they do have a role. I wouldn't claim to be an expert if you ask me to talk about one single departmental change involving technology and had it been positive or negative. I would find some difficulty of answering that specifically. But clearly it has a role. There is no area of life, private, public or voluntary sector, that is untouched by some of the positive potential within digitalisation and other technological change. There is, however, within public service, I'm going to use the horribly sounding Baumol's cost disease here, which essentially shows that person-based services are generally harder to make more efficient through technology than non-person-based services. Now, this isn't something that just affects the public sector, it affects the retail sector. You know, we've seen a whole change in terms of, you know, difficulties on our high streets because of alternative forms of purchase. We've seen changes within supermarkets themselves in terms of the balance between staff and technology. So even the private sector is trying to come to grips with the fact that it is harder to make productivity gains through technology in person-based services effectively than it is in other areas of the economy.
Okay, now I'm going to turn to the issues of pay and taxation. I mean, what's been said is that 3.5% pay risk suggested in the public sector pay strategy 23-24 is not remotely sustainable. What are the kind of average pay settlements in the public sector now? Because the graph and detail we've been provided is really from November 22, and obviously the way things have been going in recent months, you know, we're in a very unstable situation, and you know, inflation's has declined, etc. But where are we in terms of public sector pay at the moment in Scotland?
Well, I mean, all of our figures would be based on existing or settled pay deals and existing levels of inflation rather than projections of inflation, which I do agree seem likely in this uncertain world to reduce. However, as you'll see from my report, the headline is that in almost all areas, save where we've managed to negotiate particularly strong back-ended deal for some low-paid workers, pay continues to fall below inflation, and that is really a part of a decade-plus trend for both public and private sector workers, but the public sector has been particularly badly hit. And when we say that it's not sustainable, we say it's not sustainable in terms of service delivery, it's not sustainable in terms of the budgets of many of the key workers that we represent, but frankly, it's not sustainable because they're not having it, and they will take industrial action if they need to, as we've seen.
Now, with an ageing population and declining workforce that we have in Scotland, the Scottish Fiscal Commission has talked about there being a funding gap, which is likely to remain year in, year out. on current projections, and you've made a suggestion in the paper that was submitted last year that, that the Scottish Government should look to increase taxation by around £3.3 billion, which is hugely significant in terms of the tax burden that we currently have in Scotland. So, for example, someone on £43,662 a year would pay 22% income tax and 12% national insurance, and the money they've got left for that, a lot of it would probably go in, you know, fuel duty, excise duty, VAT, whatever. So basically, what would be the impact of raising that sum? I realise it wouldn't all be done in one go, of course, but what would be the impact of that on behavioural change? Because there have been concerns expressed by the Scottish Fiscal Commission that if you increase taxation to a certain degree, it results in behavioural change whereby people just don't work as hard or they move somewhere else. So I'll give you one example. One of the previous Conservative governments, Chancellor Osborne, limited pension pots to £1 million, and the result was a lot of doctors, GPs and consultants said, well, do you know what, I'm going to end up paying more in tax and I'm actually going to be gaining, so I'm just going to retire early. So that was a behavioural change which was detrimental, and the government's now, the UK government's looking to reverse that, or has reversed that to some degree. So what would be the behavioural change? Because we heard last week that there are only 18,000 top rate taxpayers in Scotland, for example.
Yeah, so there's quite a lot there, so I'll be...
There's indeed, so I'm
going to
give
you plenty
of time.
I'll be very understanding if you or somebody else needs to come back on some of the detail on this. I mean, the first thing to say, you know, you mentioned a top-line level figure of £3.3 billion. That's not what we are proposing could be achievable or possible in any one year.
I appreciate that.
And it's based upon a view, but with some specific examples of how it might be implemented, about generally how we need to shift the tax burden across the UK, across the world, frankly, but we're talking about Scotland now, away from unearned asset property-based income, more of it from that and less of it from wages. So a significant proportion of that £3.3 billion is based on proposals around wealth taxes and around property taxes. If we look at the specific, and we should say that within those proposals, there are, we think, fairly liberal estimates of tax avoidance and tax evasion. Obviously, tax is harder to avoid on fixed assets. It's not impossible, and therefore it's important within the modelling to reflect the fact that there would be some overspill in terms of loss of income. But generally speaking, one of the reasons for the shift within our proposals from income to asset over a period of time is to deal with the issue that you raised. In terms of income, we recognise, I mean, everyone knows there's a Laffer curve. The question is, how big you think the behavioural change in a Laffer curve is. Some people seem to think that we would turn around tomorrow and everybody earning, you know, if you take, for instance, our proposal to increase tax on people earning over 75,000, that everybody would disappear. I mean, the truth is that's not the case. It's partly not the case because the jobs would stay here. There's plenty of people. You know, you don't decide to suddenly start going practising law in England if you've been a Scottish lawyer for the last 30 years. You probably don't decide if your child is getting a decent education, a decent health service and a good way of life in Edinburgh just to jump the border just because somebody asks you to play a few hundred more quid. But we do recognise that there are limitations, and we're fast reaching the limitations of how we can use income alone as the basis to get fairer funding for our public services. So you'll see, you know, the value or the balance there in our recommendations sees at the most, you know, less than £1 billion being able to be raised through income tax measures and a far higher number in the medium to long term, and we're probably talking about a 3 or 4 year horizon at best, being able to be raised by a more fundamental shift in the way that we tax in Scotland.
I mean, the issue of behavioural change came up a lot last year. The Scottish Fiscal Commission, and they said that £30 million in raising top rate payers, 90% would be lost to behavioural change. And they said it wasn't about folk moving from Edinburgh to Newcastle. It was about somebody who works 5 days a week just saying, I'm only going to work 4 days a week because I just pay too much tax. And that impacts on productivity, et cetera, et cetera. So it's about that. Because I think what we all want to see is the optimum level of expenditure in our public services. And the difficulty is, given that both the main UK parties have said they won't have a wealth tax, for example, and they won't increase top rate tax, it leaves Scotland kind of exposed a wee bit in terms of within the United Kingdom, in terms of attracting, not so much keeping, retaining people, attracting people who might want to invest or come and live here. So I think, you know, I can't imagine, you're right, many people wanting to move, I certainly wouldn't want to, whatever the tax was, move south of the border. But I thought might just think, well, you know, I don't know if I want to actually go there, you know, if this is a kind of general direction of travel.
So if one includes council tax, which is significantly lower in Scotland than it is in the UK as a consequence of year-on-year council tax freezes, whatever view one takes on that, you really have to reach to the very, very highest earners to show, you know, a massive differential just now between Scotland and the UK. And we just haven't seen evidence of that migration. And whilst undoubtedly it happens at the edges, there are four or five much more significant levers for the Scottish Government, for this Parliament, to use to continue to attract investment and to continue to encourage people to live here. And that's down to decent services, but it's also down to a skilled and confident workforce that people want to invest in. So, you know, whilst I've conceded that there are limits and there's not that much further we can go before the relative benefits of raising income taxes are undermined by what we all accept is some form of slippage effect, there is a little bit further that we can go now, and we desperately need to do it, but much more fundamental reform that we need in the medium term. And I'm going to ask the question, make the point now, in case no one asks me about it. It is absolutely reprehensible that we are not, in 2023, we should have done it 10 years ago, undergoing a council tax re-evaluation, so that we actually have, you know, we have a reasonable basis going forward upon which we can begin to make the changes that we need to make sure that property is proportionally taxed and that local wealth taxes are a possibility.
Yeah, I mean, on that last point, I think it's a pragmatic thing, if I'm blunt about it. People might not talk about it publicly, but Conservative, Labour and SNP administration haven't done that because of a thing called loss aversion. The people who are better off because of that will just shrug their shoulders, but the people who actually are worse off will hate you and no vote for you. And it's actually as simple as that, to be perfectly honest, I think. I mean, people should perhaps be more honest about that. But, I mean, in terms of council tax, there's already strong opposition to the Scottish Government's proposals from within the Parliament, and members of the committee have spoken out against that publicly already. So the issue about exploring every avenue to increase tax, which is in your document, I mean, Surely that's a signal that you know that's been sent to people who feel perhaps at a time of, you know, we've had 14 interest rate rises in less than 2 years, inflation's hitting not just the public sector but the private sector, that maybe the time isn't right to do that.
I mean, it's a pretty horrible time to have to do it. No one particularly suggests that at times of relative economic downturn that overall taxation should increase, although obviously it can increase between people's ability to pay. But I'm not quite sure what our alternative is just now. I mean, you're considering, and you'll have had evidence which shows not just that particular areas of public service, whether we're talking about NHS waiting lists, whether we're talking about local government service, are in crisis. You'll also have heard evidence, which barely bears repeating, that the demography of the balance between the economy and the service that need to be provided ain't looking good for Scotland. There's some things that it would be nice to see the Scottish Government empowered to do about that, which it's not. So this is a crisis point. So we don't say with any pleasure whatsoever, particularly people on, I guess, what you describe as above average income but hardly wealthy, should be paying more taxes. We have proposed that they should, and it's no great fun to go onto a teacher's picket line and have to explain to some teachers that the way you want to fund their wage increase is by introducing tax measures which would see many of them lose a significant proportion of that. That's no fun. We're not universally popular within our own movement for coming to those conclusions. But what are the alternatives, given the other evidence that we're hearing about local government funding and about the range of other services which are in crisis? I've been spending a lot of time over the last couple of weeks and months supporting firefighters who are completely up in arms about the cuts to services that they were promised, incidentally, when the single service was introduced, wouldn't happen. Now, you know, I have to say to some of those firefighters, who earn more than £40,000 a year, that some of my proposals will cost them money. It's hard choices. It's difficult times. What else are we going to do?
I mean, I think one of the issues, of course, is that the United Kingdom's standard of living is much the same as it was in 2003, and we've been left behind by a lot of other countries. We've obviously the financial crisis, austerity, pandemic, etc. Is growth, economic growth, not the answer? And what do the STC propose to try and stimulate economic growth so that the cake is bigger? Yeah. And that itself will, of course, generate additional tax revenues.
I mean, the first thing we'd say is we don't make such a distinction as some people do between the economic growth and the overall contribution to gross national product that public services provide. So they do that generally in the sense that services are provided, services are paid through, albeit by tax income, taxes paid on that through people's wages, and that's all part of our economy. There's nothing wrong with growing an economy by growing your public services. Secondly, an awful lot of those public services are the infrastructure that are required for the private sector and the economy to grow. So if you ain't got enough planners, if you ain't got enough people in licensing, if your physical infrastructure isn't operating well, then businesses are going to pay. But of course we support sustainable economic growth. Again, it's not a straightforward question, but it seems to us that investment in the green economy, in areas of new technology, but also in improving our infrastructure, we support a national programme of retrofitting, which is similar to the one that was embarked upon in the 70s when we converted from onto North Sea gas, which provided a massive boost for the economy. So, you know, we can think of public and private ways to increase the economy. We don't see it as public sector versus private sector when we do that.
Okay, just one last question from me, and it's on the issue you've just touched on, which is about the green economy. And what you've said is that a £13 billion green stimulus package could create 150,000 jobs in Scotland, and suggest there's a pressing need for the Scottish Government to maximise the impact of its spending priorities. Now, Labour in the UK has said that it can no longer proceed with its £28 billion green prosperity plan because of affordability. So how can Scotland, with 8.2% of the UK's population, do something as ambitious as a £13 billion stimulus package?
It probably couldn't under existing borrowing and capital spending limits. That's our, I think that was our top level in the middle of the pandemic. 2 year, this could really make a revolutionary difference kind of figure. But you can also look within that report to, and we produced a subsequent one which show kind of, I guess, a spectrum of investment decisions all the way from the, frankly, where we currently are now in terms of the failure to produce jobs out of the renewable economy through to better outcomes. So, yeah, I'm not going to sit here and say that the Finance Minister can find £6 million in subsequent years to make that investment. And I would just take this opportunity to say we strongly oppose the change in UK government, in Labour Party, hope to be UK government policy when it comes to those levels of investment. I mean, we foresee and we will continue to agitate for a new government at a UK level, and a new government that is prepared to make those investments, and then a new government which is prepared to work with the Scottish Parliament and government up here to say how would that the proportion of that investment be best deployed in Scotland. So, yeah, I ain't going to defend that policy change from the Labour Party.
Okay, well, thank you very much for that. Okay, I'm going to open out to colleagues, and the first person to ask questions will be a Deputy Convener, Michael, to be followed by John.
Thanks, Convener. So your submission that you've made, Dave, is very critical, I suppose, of the resource spending review that was previously published by the government. I wonder whether you could outline why.
I guess fundamentally because it identified public spending as a standalone item. So, I'll just give an example. If I'm looking at the revenues that are spent on public services, if I look at the income that is derived from taxation, I also want to look at things like business support, small business bonus scheme. So for me, some things were left aside as kind of like, well, we're obviously going to continue to spend 300 million plus on the small business bonus scheme. Whereas for us, that should have been in the round. And we were also critical because its headline figure foresaw, now I know that this has been slightly nuanced since, foresaw a cut in the public sector workforce, which we don't support. So, yeah, I mean, given our view that hard decisions need to be made on the resource side, that hard decisions need to be made on the relief side as well as the income side, and that particular areas of government, local government in particular, has in our view been historically underfunded, we were unlikely to be super positive about it.
So we had the Permanent Secretary in front of us back on the 16th of May, and he told us it wasn't clear to him what the status of the resource spending review was within government. So the new First Minister at that time had not given them any kind of direction. Do you understand what the current status of the resource spending review is?
Not really. I mean, we've heard suggestions that some of the elements of that returning to the kind of the very unfortunate kind of quantification of jobs that needed to be cut from the public sector has been nuanced, but we're not enormously sure. I mean, I think it's reasonable to concede that a change of First Minister and Cabinet would presage some alterations to policy. We've seen that in other areas, arguably in other areas such as the Scottish National Care Service. So I think, and obviously the last 2 months has largely been a politically quiet period, as it always has. So I wouldn't necessarily say that our uncertainty about its exact status is, you know, a final and massive criticism. It would be nice, particularly in the next couple of months, particularly running up to the next budget, to have a much clearer idea of what government intention is.
That's a fair point. And I suppose those issues around the civil service, you know, part of the issue that the Permanent Secretary raised with us, the issues about capacity, their ability to deliver the kind of plans. So, for instance, you know, within the first 2 years of a Labour government, Labour's committed to building up towards £28 billion of investment across the UK in green technology. We have to be in a position as a country to develop those plans as a whole. So do you have concerns about our capacity as a country to meet that aspiration of a new government to make that investment?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a really good point, and I hope slightly digressing into another area is okay in terms of illustrating the point. We're obviously fairly keen, as I'm sure members of the Parliament are aware, on the development of municipal bus models. Now, you know, a municipal, you know, if we said yes today, it would be 5 or 6 years probably before such a thing could be achieved. And one of the major issues there would be, do we have the capacity to develop it? So we've often found this with other areas such as like procurement reform and, you know, best intentions to use public spending through public bodies to their best effect, that we haven't had the capacity within the local bodies, procurement, the procurement expertise, actually to begin to build the new model. So, you know, to return to my original point, that capacity issue within local authorities, within the civil service, the capability for government, where possible, to do it for itself, particularly, and we've been critical of this, where the alternative is to bring in, you know, big public sector reform bodies. I won't name any of them, but I think we know which ones we're talking about. There is that issue, and it does return me to this point that if you're going to do public sector reform, then you have to get your ducks in a row, and you have to get your capacity strong enough to actually deliver it, and your vision strong enough before you start making cuts in other areas.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you. That's John to follow by Ross.
Thanks very much, convener. Mr Maxim, you said earlier on you kind of favoured reform being at a more local level, and I would tend to kind of agree with that if I understood you correctly. But it has been suggested to us that sometimes there's a need for a central drive. For example, police and fire would never have reorganised the way they did, for good or bad, if it hadn't been for a central drive. So how do you think, when we're looking at public sector reform, how much do we leave it to the individual organisations, and how much should government or parliament be driving it?
Yeah, I mean, it's quite a general question, and it's difficult not to answer it simply by saying, I mean, the principle of subsidiarity is obviously the founding principle of that, and therefore, from our point of view, the burden of proof, so to speak, for non-local solutions should be on central government. Now, that burden of proof may be provided in given circumstances. I don't think anybody would be arguing for the further breakup. I certainly don't think so of health boards, for instance. I think I wouldn't say it's problem-free, far from it, I think most people would accept that, you know, significant national priorities, significant national outcomes, significant strategies must be adopted and must be driven by government. But my principle would be that it's down to central government to demonstrate why it's not delivered better locally. Mm-hmm.
I mean, do you think on the whole, because it has been suggested to us there's too many public bodies, several are perhaps overlapping with each other, what they're doing?
Yeah, I mean, we've historically been, I guess, critical of, most people remember this, critical of the creation of Quangos, NDPBs, which don't have the prerequisite levels of accountability, and being in favour wherever possible to maintain democratic delivery, and even, you know, in some cases to strengthen that where there is, you know, local government, local authority, councillor representation on NDPBs and other local boards to ensure that that's strengthened. I find it hard to... It's quite a general question.
Yes, exactly.
And I'm sure that both the workforce within some of these NDPBs, not to mention the managers, would have some, if you like, localised observations on how one might improve that landscape. But as I say, our general position is as local as possible, as democratic as possible.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, I mean, I agree largely with that. I mean, one of the particular issues, specific issues that's come up to us as a committee recently has been the number of commissioners in Scotland. There's Commissioner for Children, for Human Rights. It's proposed to have one for disabled people, a wide range of these. Do you have any particular view about them? Because some people think they are a bit undemocratic. They're not answerable to anyone.
A slight hesitation. I wasn't particularly expecting to have to consider this. I mean, I do think that where government has priorities, and where government has priorities which are new and national and require particular attention, then certainly the creation, whether it be for a finite term or a longer term, of people who are specifically tasked with looking at agency delivery in a particular area, bringing that together, informing government policy. There's undoubtedly some value in that. Do I think that everything should have a commission? No. I think it should be where there is a large consensus amongst the Parliament and amongst the wider population that a particular issue requires a particular focus for a particular period of time. Most of these things should not be forever.
Okay. Well, I appreciate your comments anyway. I mean, it's something we're just looking at the moment. I realise maybe you weren't anticipating it, so that was maybe a little unfair, but anyway. On the general point of, I mean, clearly one of your roles and your colleagues' roles is to defend existing jobs, but if we're looking at reform, I mean, I suppose I'd like to see, you know, a bit more on workers on the front line, a bit fewer sitting behind desks. I mean, are you open to that kind of movement?
We're open to it. I often smile. I spent quite a long time in the early 2010s talking about the distinction between front and back office staff, shared services and various other things. And we did feel that many of those distinctions were illusory. Obviously, you can look at the payroll function potentially of a public service body and the frontline delivery and say, I can see a real clear distinction there. Very often the distinction is far more blurred. One of the concerns we have, and the answer to the point is yes, but how, and how is that going to be organised? One of the concerns that we have is that some public service reform initiatives have tended to try and chop away particular parts of a function under the illusion that it makes it more efficient, but it actually reduces the KPIs, and the main KPI is, can you shift that job onto somebody else? So I think we've all had it in terms of, when we phone up and get the automated or non-automated service on the phone, and the thing they seem to be best at is telling you that it's somebody else's job. And that's normally because they've been told to shift a whole range of inquiries and a whole range of problems into somebody else's lap, and that looks very, very efficient to that small department, but it doesn't look efficient if you look at the whole of public service delivery. And one of my concerns is we need as many people in public service who are qualified and paid to be problem solvers, which means, we've heard an awful lot of chat about over the years about following people's delivery journey through service provision from point A to point B and point C, and making sure that public service journey is strong. Sometimes when you split away the so-called back office function from the front office function, you actually reduce the number of people within the service who are problem solvers, who are able to pick people along a slightly longer part of that journey. So yes, that's a very long way of saying yes with a but at the end, John.
No, that's a fair answer. Thank you. I mean, one of the other things that witnesses have been saying to us, and it's been mixture, has been looking back at COVID and what happened then, that might be a good model for going forward, or others have said it might be a bad model for going forward. I think some of the key themes were decisions were made more quickly on the positive side, and some of the bureaucratic systems were kind of chopped a bit. But on the bad side, maybe there was less consultation before decisions were made. So I just wonder if you have a view generally during, again, it's a wide question, but generally during COVID, were there good things that happened that we could take forward?
I think there were some good things that happened, which were probably amplifications of things that happen on a day-to-day basis that we don't see, and that's the day-to-day engagement with different parts of the public service together. To deliver, we've long advocated for what we describe as public service networks, which really looks at how you strengthen the formal but sometimes informal cooperation between different areas of the public service to really optimise local delivery. You use the fact that these people very often attend the same incidents or are part of the same review panel, for a social work outcome, and you build upon those. And I think that by nature of geography, by nature of the need for immediacy, we did see some good examples of people, I guess, just using some of the informal networks and some of the more formal networks that they had very effectively, very decisively and very dynamically. Would I build out of that a suggestion that we need less consultation? I'd probably say no. I mean, I think it's an important plank of Christie that service users continue to be consulted on a high level basis in terms of the services they deliver. And I certainly think that workers need consulted and not just directed. But there are undoubtedly some dynamic examples of people pulling their sleeves up, building on pre-existing relationships and delivering very effectively in communities.
OK, thanks. That's helpful as well. And just a final point out of your own submission I wanted to ask you about. Paragraph 5. Talking about, the 3.5% increase that the convener mentioned, and you said if they do not, real wages in Scotland are likely to fall further behind the UK. So is your suggestion that currently wages across the public sector or elsewhere are behind the UK? Or?
We're talking about a fall rather than an absolute level, and those figures, as I recall, I will get back to you and correct you if I'm wrong on this, were based on 2022 figures for relative wage growth or relative wage decrease in this case, compared across the nations and regions of the UK.
Because in some sectors, Scottish workers are paid more than the equivalent.
So the question is whether we're comparing a fall or whether we're comparing absolute levels. And certainly the fall more recently has been more acute in Scotland than across the UK. That shouldn't be taken to suggest that we think that the public sector workforce or any other part of the workforce as a whole is paid less in Scotland than across the UK.
Right. OK, that's helpful. Thanks, convener.
OK, thank you. Ross, to follow by Liz.
Thanks. Just as a point of clarification, in the first instance, Dave, on your income tax proposals, am I right in understanding that you're not proposing, beyond threshold freezes, you're not proposing any changes to the starter, basic and intermediate rates? It would just be your new 40 grand threshold for the new, whatever the lower high rate would be called and above. But there's nothing really at those lower thresholds?
No, that's correct, yeah.
Okay. On a wider point, something that this committee has discussed quite a lot recently is the challenge, as the convener pointed out, with the financial gap that the SFC have identified. Even if we were to make substantial tax changes, substantial tax rises, such as the ones that you've proposed, or even that my party's proposed, it would be to mitigate, to prevent potential cuts rather than to expand public services. Do you have any concerns around public consent for that? Because quite consistently in Scotland, polls have shown that people, including those on higher incomes, are willing to pay more tax if it results in better quality services, more services, etc. What we would be doing if we embarked on tax rises over the next few years is simply preventing tax cuts. It's hard for people to identify something that they've not lost as opposed to something they've gained. How would you manage the public consent around that?
I think it's really hard to manage. I think that the economic conditions that many people find themselves in, frankly, includes people, because you can earn a reasonable amount of money, but you still have a budget that's set and things that you do, so you still see yourself losing some things, even if they may be things that aren't available to other members of the population. So it's an incredibly difficult discussion to have. And to refer back, I guess, to the convener's point about it never being very politically popular to do things around tax. I mean, that's absolutely true. And without getting too overly heroic about it, I do think it's incumbent upon the parties of the Parliament to have a discussion about tax and have a discussion about services, which recognises some of these fundamentals. The fundamental that in 10 years' time we are going to be spending more as a proportion of our income on public services than we do now is a fact. Nobody in this House would dispute that fact. So can we say it all together? I think most people think that the council tax is bust and that it's frankly ridiculous that we're still basing our system on a 1991 review. Everybody believes that. So if there's some things that we can at least say together, then I think it begins to make that more palatable. It's totally understandable, and I agree with you, Convener. You know, I wouldn't be want to be the one with that particular stick at any given time. So what can we do collectively just to say where we all genuinely recognise that there's a really significant problem here? Can we at least find some sort of starting point? And that means that the conversation that I have to have with my members, that you have to have with your electors, it's at least based upon the fact that there's a genuine recognition of a shared problem.
Absolutely agree with you that there's a need for greater cross-party consensus around at least some of this, and always happy to speak to cross-party colleagues about tax policy. Yeah. But there's an element of this, there's an understandable public cynicism about politicians. So, for example, if my party, the SNP, is going out with a new, you know, real push in public information campaign to sell to people the public services that already exist, people are going to quite understandably say, well, look at your waiting times in the NHS, or you're just saying that because you want our votes at the next election. So my question back to you, as much as I think we should still do that, my question back to you is, what role does the trade union movement have to play in getting the buy-in of wider society? You have, you know, over 500,000 members, but we've got a working age population of, what, about 4 million people. What role can the trade union movement play in getting that wider societal buy-in here? And not even buy-in, but just recognition of what the financial reality is right now.
Well, we spend quite a lot of time trying to get ourselves certainly into the media, and we've been quite successful. And one of our priority campaigns for this year is basically we want to tax quite a lot of people more, and we've been very public about that. Our members know that, the general public knows that, and we'll continue to make the argument for that, and we'll continue to link it not just to obviously the welfare of the members that we represent, but the pride in the services that they deliver. So we'll continue to do that. Our other priority campaigns are the National Care Service, which I think everybody recognises is an organisational but also a funding issue. So I guess the first thing I'd say is we've been right up there. We have not gone to government, as perhaps we have in the past and other bodies in the past, and said, we need this much extra for public services, and it's simply down to you to bear the responsibility for the political debate about that, how that happens. We have an alternative. It may not be popular, it may not be deliverable in all its aspects, but I think I think we can take some comfort from the fact that we're not avoiding those difficult questions in terms of where the money comes from.
Yeah, I think SDUC does deserve commendation for that. Plenty of other organisations, bodies, representative groups come to this committee every single year wanting more, but are unwilling to say where that should come from, or indeed wanting more public spending, but no tax rises or even tax cuts. Final questions just around the public sector estate. The union movement's obviously been a champion of flexible working, remote working, working conditions that actually suit the needs of workers themselves. Post-pandemic, that genie isn't going back into the bottle, and that's particularly true in the public sector. What that's resulted in, though, is a number of buildings that are either owned or leased by public sector organisations being largely empty or certainly significantly under occupancy. Now, does the SDUC recognise that that's inefficient, that's not a good use of public money, and therefore there does need to be a reform of the public sector estate, not simply as a cost-saving exercise in the way that there was off the back of 2010 austerity, but in recognition of the fact that we are no longer working in an environment where everybody is in the same office Monday to Friday, 9 to 5?
Yeah, I think it's entirely sensible that, broadly speaking, and there will be examples where I would possibly disagree with myself, broadly speaking, empty buildings, particularly heating empty buildings, yeah, is a bad idea. I think what their use becomes is really very much the issue. I mean, certainly, if there's not a market for, if there's more space than we need to house public sector staff, there's also probably more space than we need to to fund office workers and people in the private sector too. Some of this is a general trend. Yeah. So I think use is important. I think, you know, I think some of, and I've been critical of some of the areas of it, some of the work that local authorities have done, some of the work that, you know, Glasgow's done in terms of looking to begin to reimagine what Glasgow City Centre looks like in terms of its balance between dwelling and commercial. These are, you know, these are things that have to be looked at. These are things that, as I say, we may not agree with every single one of the outcomes, but that's not really the point. The point is there is going to be significant repurposing going on. That does have an implication for the green economy and what we do in relation to our infrastructure, travel to work times and various other things. So, yeah, we're not going to sit there and say let Glasgow be full of empty buildings if we can think of a good social purpose for them. It's just important to recognise that the market is probably a challenging one just now for what would have been the old method of simply sell it onto the private sector for more office accommodation.
Thank you. Thanks, Commissioner.
Thank you. Liz?
Thank you. I completely agree with you that if we were to reform council tax, we'd first need to have a revaluation, which is long overdue. Can I just ask a few questions about what your specific proposal would be to replace council tax, which I think you've mentioned in your thing about this proportional property tax. Could you just be very specific about how you think that works?
Yes, the first thing to say is we have quite a range of recommendations in our tax paper. It's definitely more than illustrative, but we're not stating just now that we've come up with a dot and comma system for replacing it. There would be a certain amount of arrogance of that, given the failure of everybody to come up with a satisfactory scheme over generations. But largely speaking, it would be based, obviously it would require a re-evaluation, and then people would pay, and I think we give illustrative examples of the percentage of that value, that would essentially become their local council tax. So if I owned a property value, I wish I did, values at £500,000, and if the if 1% were chosen, it wouldn't need to be, it could be 0.6%, it could be 0.8%, then that would come up with my council tax bill. So if it was 1% and my property was valued at £500,000, my council tax bill would be £5,000 a year.
And if that happened, would you also be in favour of the wealth tax that you suggested in your paper?
Yeah, it would somewhat complicate the wealth tax in the sense that property is a component part of obviously a bigger basket. So we wouldn't necessarily suggest that bringing those two things in so that somebody was essentially double taxed on the value of their property would necessarily be the way that we would go. We would want to avoid double taxation on property.
Could I suggest that would be very important because it would be double taxation, and I think you would be in very considerable danger, not only of creating very considerable bills for some people who actually might not necessarily be particularly at the top end of the scale, but also administratively. I think that could be very complex indeed, and I think local authorities, because as I understand it, this Parliament doesn't, as you know, have powers to tax what is on a non-income basis, as in we can't have a national wealth tax. But the wealth tax that was suggested in your paper, I think, is to be administered locally.
That's correct.
Does that not provide quite a complex area in relation to also having the...
I think it's unlikely that we're going to come up with a tax system that isn't complicated, to be quite honest with you, and doesn't have a whole range of administrative challenges. The current one absolutely does. And there's no property-based scheme, including the one that we currently have, that doesn't need a fairly active compensation scheme for the people that you talk about.
I think the issue, which you also came to later on in your tax paper, is about business tax as well. And I think the key issue for the Scottish economy just now is to get the right balance between the tax take, the tax revenue, which you suggested various ways to increase. I may disagree with you on some of that. But the behavioural change, and I think the convener pointed out an example of behavioural change that was really quite significant. And it's trying to work out on a projection basis what would happen with various scenarios. And I'm just keen to know what the STUC would pick out as a sort of priority basis for that.
A priority basis for
what would you in making recommendations about changing tax? I'm not entirely clear whether you want to change the rates of taxation, or whether you want specific structural changes to the overall tax basis. That's a key question, which is what the Scottish Fiscal Commission is asking as well.
Yeah. Well, we want structural changes to the way that tax is levied, because we want more of it to be based upon immovable assets than we do on income. I wouldn't go as far as the famous half quote from Peter Mandelson, but one can be more relaxed about people earning high amounts of income if they're at least paying effective tax on their property and their assets. So that is a structural change. That's undoubtedly a structural change, because it suggests that we do what we can, recognising the limitations of the Parliament, and we'd obviously be advocating that at UK level as well, to change the structural emphasis from income to asset when it comes to taxing people. Mm.
Yeah, I mean, I come back to the point that I think what we all want for the Scottish economy is a much more sustainable future in terms of the revenue that we bring in line with what is going to be increased expenditure that's necessary, particularly in things like health and social care and social security. And obviously that tax revenue is absolutely vital to the future. And if we're going to have both increased taxation on certain members of the population, plus also structural changes, I think we have to be very clear that what we're suggesting is not going to provide the disincentives of the sort that the convener set out. It's not that people are necessarily going to move elsewhere, it's just that they might think, well, this isn't very good for us, we don't like this extra burden of taxation, so we won't work quite as much, which is a very considerable problem for the economy. But also from a business angle, people think, do we want a higher tax burden in Scotland? Probably not. Do you accept that that's a view that certainly business and industry holds?
Well, we accept it. We, for instance, the wealth tax proposals within our recommendations do model for some of that to happen. We would argue that the overall benefit, which would be funding not just in, if you like, public services, but potentially in other investment and other investments available to business and improvements in the workforce for them, would provide a very positive, on balance, a more positive environment for business to operate in. And there are plenty of countries with significantly higher taxes, both on individuals and business, that have proved that it really is the high road rather than the low road that matters in terms of...
But would you accept in some of these countries that they have a better quality of the delivery of public services than currently we do in Scotland?
Absolutely, and particularly the ones where universalism is more widespread, where people have,
indeed,
for want a better a social contract, where they are quite happy to pay relatively high levels of taxation because the quality and cost of things like childcare are significantly lower. There's a very strong case to be made that's better for the economy as well as better.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. That appears to have concluded questions from the committee. I'm just point out that, ironically, the council tax was only meant to be a temporary fix when it actually came in over 30 years ago. And I think one of the difficulties we probably haven't touched on is the fact that if we did have a new system, whatever that system would be, the number of appeals would run into the hundreds of thousands, because that's what happened when the council tax came in, as I remember from my own days in Glasgow City Council. David, just to wind up, are there any points you want to make that perhaps we haven't touched on?
No, I mean, simply to emphasise, and I'm a member of the Scottish Government's new tax advisory group, so I recognise that I and my organisation will have more than one opportunity to push this forward. But one of the things, and I don't think I'm giving any secrets away, that we discussed in the first meeting was there are three different broad areas of taxation income raising that we can think about. There are things that can be done now that need to be done for the next budget. They are limited, but they are possible. There are additional powers. We've just seen the new fiscal framework come out, which didn't go as far as we would like, but added a bit more. There are new powers, and some of those powers aren't just about fiscal powers. They're about increasing the powers of the Parliament, for instance, over some aspects of migration, which would allow us to build and grow our tax base. But there's some stuff in the middle, which is things that we can do under devolved competences, but will take a number of years to do, but we need to get started now. And we don't want to be in the situation in 5 or 6 years' time of sitting around and saying, we still all agree that the council tax needs to be reformed, or we still all agree that we need to look in more detail at land taxes and find out that we haven't completed the registry or we haven't started the process of a new revaluation. So I'd be really, really urging those things. It's not like the trade union movement to think 5 years ahead, but normally worried about what's happening tomorrow. But I would encourage this committee and anybody else to really think very clearly about the things that we need to do now, that we can do now, that will put us in a position in 4 or 5 years' time to have a greater range of options when it comes to the fiscal challenges that we know we're going to face.
Okay. Thank you very much for taking the time to speak to the committee today. The Evans Guard from this inquiry will help us inform the committee's pre-budget 24-25 scrutiny, including an Evans session with the Deputy First Minister in early October. That concludes the public part of today's meeting. The next item on our agenda, which will be discussed in private, is consideration of a work programme. So I'll now move into private session and just have a couple of minutes break in order to allow our witness and official report to leave.